Hello, welcome to Italics. I'm Lucia Grillo. With us is actor Michael Badalucco, with over 50 films and 25 TV shows under his belt, ranging from Raging Bull to Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, and Boardwalk Empire to The Young and the Restless. Michael has earned top accolades, being nominated by his peers for the Screen Actors Guild Awards and winning an Emmy for his role as Jimmy Berluti in The Practice, which ran for 7 seasons. Michael, thanks so much for being with us today.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks.
So I've got to say, the first time I met you, I narrowly escaped death at your hands.
Why? How can I forget such a thing? Death at my hands. Not my hands.
No, not yours. The character. How was that playing the son of Sam?
Oh, you know, it was very strange because I wanted to get into his mind. You know, Spike really didn't show David Berkowitz living his life. He just showed this evil, this aspect of evil, and. For me, I wanted to sort of delve into how can a person be so evil? What inside a person makes them do such horrendous things? And I was going to this deep, dark place, and I was sort of studying. I would buy this music on CDs, Cannibal Corpse, Nine Inch Nails. I would listen to this music, and my wife would say, "Will you shut that off? Put on headphones." It was terrible. It would just be something that would affect your mind. So. I just wanted to go to a sort of a deep, dark place, and I'm glad I went there, and I'm glad I left
you
too.
And that wasn't the first time you worked with Spike. You were also in Jungle Fever.
Yes, Jungle Fever was a lot of fun. It was a little more lighthearted in an aspect. But those days, Spike, you know, was at the beginning of his career, and we had time to improvise, and it was really great experiences working with him.
You grew up pretty much. Kind of like related to the film industry. Your dad was a set carpenter.
Yes, my dad was a carpenter on movie sets, and he built sets for a lot of TV commercials when I was very, very young. I used to go to the job with him, and you know, he would be building, so it wouldn't be when they were shooting, so I'd go on the camera dolly and get all the hydraulics out. I'd go up and down, and I'd push it, and So I'd learn about, you know, the lights and what the grip stands did and all that. And then little by little, when I got out of college, I had a BA in theater arts. But instead of being a waiter, I worked as a prop man. Uh-huh. And like Yogi Berra says, you can observe a lot by watching. Mm-hmm. So I learned all aspects of the film business. I was fortunate to do that. That's but my father was a master carpenter, and he worked on many, many Woody Allen films, talking about Brooklyn, my Brooklyn roots. Annie Hall, Woody Allen's character, Alvy Singer, grew up under the cyclone, if you remember the movie, and his apartment used to shake. My father built the cyclone there, and the Wonder Wheel, and all the sets for Annie Hall, which actually won an Oscar for Best Picture.
Wow, fantastic. So was that where you got your inspiration from?
Well, you know, I think a lot of us Italians, we stay in the family business, and I think being around the sets and feeling comfortable there, and I wasn't much of a carpenter, but I always started with passion plays at St. Brendan's. I would act as the Roman guard who crucified Jesus or something, and it was something I could always do, and then when I went to Severian High School, I did a lot of plays there, and I sort of found my identity in acting. And then I went to New Paltz State and majored in theater. I actually got in through the theater department. And then I said, you know, this is really what I want to do. This is who I am. Mm-hmm. So I really put my focus on that. And 20 years after I graduated college, I got a steady job, which you mentioned, The Practice.
Yeah, I want to get to that. But I also want to ask you, Tell us a little bit what a prop master does, because I think maybe our viewers don't know.
Well, if this is a movie, which it could be, I would be the guy that put that TV there, set it up. I'd give each other water. Now, if I drink this whole water and we want to do another take, mm-hmm. I got to refill the glass. Mm-hmm. I give you your props and your pen if you pick it up and put it over here. Oh, wait, we're doing this take again. You got to put it back there.
Exactly.
So I take care of all the hand props for the actors. And working on the Woody Allen movies, it was a great experience because I got to, you know, see how Woody Allen worked. And, you know, I got to talk to different actors. And it was a wonderful experience, you know. And you have respect for the crew because the crew is just as important as the person in front of the camera,
absolutely.
You know. Those things really helped me when I was ready. You know, I'm sort of well-rounded. In many ways, I guess.
Yeah, and it's great. I mean, it's great to know all the details about, you know, what affects your craft and to know what the different roles that people play.
Right.
And it's also part of movie magic. I always love walking on a set and seeing that, you know, all these people are part of creating the
magic.
Right,
whether it's wardrobe or hair or makeup,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. You also sing, is that?
Well, I sing. I don't know if you call it singing, but you know, my second semester there, they were doing a funny thing happened on the way to the forum, mm-hmm. and it's not really a singing role. I'm sure you're familiar. Pseudolist. You know, it's singing, but it's not Mario Lanza singing. So I auditioned for this musical, and here I am getting the lead as a freshman in a funny thing happened on the way to the forum. So that sort of said, well, if I can do this, you know. But luckily, I just enjoy sitting in an opera and listening to Giuseppe Verdi's music.
Do you like opera? Do you go often?
And I've only come to it here in the last 20 years. Mm-hmm. But I had a friend in high school and a teacher, and they used to go to the opera all the time, and they wanted to get me involved. And I remember vividly, his name was Joe Colombo, he playing a record for me to listen to this music. And it was either the chorus from Nabucco or maybe the Aida Triumphal March, I don't remember. But I listened to it and I said, oh, this is good. You know, but I'd rather be at the basketball game, so I never really did it. But now in these years, oh, I can't get enough of it.
Oh, it's weird. Yeah, I haven't got, I used to go to the opera to the Met. Actually, my first experience in opera, going to the opera was in Verona. In Italy, and because I was a student traveling for the first time on my own in Italy, I bought, you know, the least expensive ticket, which was way up in the top
right.
of the amphitheater. And I thought that was probably the best seat because, and I don't know how it was down on the bottom, but I had like the best of both worlds, this like grand opera happening, you know, below me. And then like this, you know, this starry Italian sky and like all the bustling of the people, you know, strolling in the evening, having their evening walks and stuff below, in the street below. It was just magical.
Oh, it sounds magical. Yeah, I know. Someday I want to go to an opera in Europe.
Oh, wow. But then where do you usually go? To the Met?
To the Met, yeah. Or now when I'm in L.A., you know, they have the transmissions, the HD transmissions in the movie theater, so I see all of those.
I once saw Pavarotti with Placido Domingo in I Pagliacci with Zeffirelli's sets.
Oh, wow, that's wonderful.
Zeffirelli's sets are incredible.
Yes.
So let's get back to you. You were discovered by De Niro and then kind of rediscovered by Michelle Pfeiffer.
Well, discovered. We were doing a play down at the Westbed Theater Center, and Robert De Niro showed up to the play. Now, I'm going to make a long story short because this can go on and on. But what happened was he saw me in the play, and he said he wanted me and the guy taking tickets, who was in a T-shirt, happened to be John Turturro, because he went to college with me. He's younger than me. And he was there to audition for a play, for a movie. So the movie we knew was Raging Bull, but there was no script. So I said to John, let's get this book, Raging Bull. So, like I say, we got the book, Raging Bull. We took out a scene. We wrote a scene from the book. We prepared it for about a week. And then we dressed in the character period, the 40s outfit, you know, in a village that used to have antique clothes stores. Mm-hmm. And we did all this. And then we did something else, which I'm not going to tell you. Oh, I will tell you. I was a prop man. So I went to the prop truck, and I asked the boss if I could borrow two 38s. They're fake guns. And I put him in a little bag and wrapped him in a towel, like The Godfather 2. I said to John, when we go in, we're going to have this bag, right? If they don't let us do our scene, We're going to pull out the guns because we know these guys are violent. We saw a Taxi Driver. We saw a Mean Street. We're going to say, we want to do the scene. We didn't have to resort to that. But they let us do this little scene, and I'll never forget to this day, Robert De Niro. It was a little room just like this. Me and John Turturro were here acting our hearts out, whatever we were doing. And Scorsese was sort of skeptical, but De Niro was there like this, looking at, look at these two guys. You know, look at he's trying so hard. And they gave us both a part. I had a speaking part.
Fantastic.
I was a soda fountain clerk. And then John came in later at the table. So he appeared in that film, too. And that was the first time I appeared in a movie. And I got my SAG card from that.
What a story. That's great. And then your rediscovery by Michelle Pfeiffer.
Well, this coincidence, and it's from the heavens above for sure. I was in a movie with Michelle Pfeiffer called One Fine Day, mm-hmm. and I had a small scene with her. I was a police officer, mm-hmm. and there was a missing child. But a week before, I just happened to audition for a small part in the pilot of The Practice of a flasher, you know, one of these guys. I like to say they gave it to someone bigger than me, taller than me. And but anyway, Michelle Pfeiffer comes home and shows her husband, just happens to be David Kelly, mm-hmm. said, I work with an actor that proved the adage there are no small parts, only small actors, and shows him the dailies of my scene with her. And he says, you got to be kidding. This is the guy that auditioned for me last week, and I want to write. I was thinking about writing a part for him. He was.
Wow.
So these two things came together. Wow. David Kelly wound up writing me into the first episode of The Practice, and then I continued on for 8 seasons.
And on The Practice, you played Jimmy Bertolucci.
Yes.
And I have a couple of questions about this. One is that you had this character name on 4 different shows.
Well, because at that time, The Practice was so popular that I'd go over to Ally McBeal and I tried to date her, and I was Jimmy Bertolucci. Right? And then he had another show about a Boston public school, I mm-hmm. forget the name of it. And then he had me go over there, because it was still in Boston, as this lawyer, Jimmy Bertolucci, on the other show.
Okay.
And there was another ABC show, a doctor show called Gideon's Crossing,
right.
and they wanted to do a tie-in with The Practice to try to give it a good jump.
Uh-huh.
And me and Cameron, her character was mm-hmm. Eleanor Frutt, we both were lawyers representing this hospital the characters from The Practice.
That's great. So how is that, like playing this character in a different
dynamic? Yeah, well, I love the character of Jimmy. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was, just a real down-to-earth sort of, Italian. He was, true to his roots and values. And, he was a good character to play. I enjoyed him because he had... He had battles with himself, too, but he always tried to do the right thing. He was always struggling to make sure that this is coming out all right, and I'm not... One of the best episodes, if I just can say it quickly, how wonderful that material was. David Kelly presents me with a script. Jimmy Bertolucci, his mother, his father had died, and his mother wanted to get remarried. So the mother comes to the office and says, Jimmy, I want to get remarried. So right away, there's a little doubt. I want to marry somebody. And Jimmy's, a little, okay, well, you can marry. But Jimmy, I want to marry a woman.
Are you, dual sexual, or are you the other?
I'm gay, Jimmy.
Not gay. You can't be gay. You were married to Dad.
That's what women of my generation did. We married men. It didn't matter whether you were heterosexual or not.
Did Dad know?
I think he always suspected. Eventually, I told him.
Is that what killed him? I think it's sick. Disgusting.
I'm sorry you feel that way. That's not the way I raised you. And I don't think it's how your father raised you.
We let sex offenders marry and have children. We let people in prison get married. We let convicted deadbeat dads marry again. So let's not preach about the sanctity of some institution. It's everybody's right to get married. Why don't they get it? I hate the fact that my mother's a lesbian. I admit that. But I've also never been more proud of her.
Now, how fantastic is that for an actor? And this is way before all this happening in the Supreme Court now. This was in the late 90s.
This is part of the gift of being in the arts, right? Because I think the arts kind of have an eye towards society and what's happening and where is it going. And,
yes, and David Kelly had that for sure in that show. Yeah. When the show was at its best, we dealt with so many issues, ethical issues, and people would tell me when they would watch the show Monday morning, they'd discuss it, you know, and so it wasn't just TV just to escape, it was something that it was relevant.
Playing this character, who's Italian-American, was it much different from playing a character, say, as your character in the film Mac?
Well, they were different guys, Vico Vitelli, yeah.
We gotta get in a better predicament.
Rome wasn't built in a day, two brothers and a sheep.
Romulus and Remus.
That's the guys.
She wants to start her own business?
And who is better than us anyway?
But I mean, you know, when I, well, obviously, you know, I'm very close to my roots and my heritage, so whenever I get to, you know, play someone with an Italian background, you know, I can dig deep down inside and come up with something, whether it's, you know, a good trait or a trait that's not so nice to look at, you know. So certainly different character. Yeah, well, the one guy was a worker and one guy was a professional, a lawyer, you know, and you know, you wouldn't think of a guy like me, usually the lawyers on TV are a little more slicker, you know. but there's all kinds of lawyers.
Absolutely.
Right?
So now, tell us a little bit about your family. Like your dad is from Sicily.
Yes, my dad was born in Pacheco, Sicily, in the region of Trapani, and he grew up as a he was a cabinet maker. You know, worked with wood. He was a master craftsman, and his goddaughter, his niece actually, went to America to get married, and when his niece came back to show her uncle the photos of the wedding, he saw a picture of this lovely girl. It was in the bridal party, and he said, "Who is this?" "Oh, that's Vincenza Bonomo." "Vincenza Bonomo. You think I could write to her?" So they asked my, turned out to be my grandfather, and he wrote to my mother for about 3 or 4 years, letters, and he proposed marriage to her through letters. And then he came, he couldn't get into this country, so he had to go to Canada and work as a mushroom farmer.
Oh, wow.
So he was a bit of an actor, too, because he was never a mushroom farmer, and he had to convince the judge that he could be a mushroom farmer, and he worked 2 years up there, and they got married in Toronto, and then they moved back to Brooklyn.
Wow.
So my mother's parents were also born in Pacheco, but we weren't related, and my father was born in Pacheco. So I'm Sicilian through and through.
So you've gone back to Pacheco.
Yes, yes. One of the wonderful experiences was the first time I went there, and I went to the town, and I was with some cousins. They live in another town called Marauza, and we went into Pacheco, and they would go into someone's home, and they were known. "Oh, Ninetta, how are you?" And then I would just stand there, and then there was the time of the godfather. I had a little cap on like this, and I was a little thin. And I said, "Who?" You know, and finally they'd say, "Well, who's this boy? Who's this young man?" "And questo figlio de Peppino Badalucco." "Peppino Badalucco!" You know, and they're giving me hugs and dinners, and oh, it was so wonderful. And I had everybody, I took the Polaroids of everybody and had them writing a book to my father, and they had the picture of them. Yeah, it was just wonderful experience. I felt like family. I didn't even, you know, they all knew my father growing up, whether it was the barber or the butcher or, you know, someone in town, you know. So it was a great experience. And I went back the following year immediately. I said, I have to go back to Sicily. So beautiful, beautiful heritage. Wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah, and I've seen pictures of the town. It's just
beautiful area, and very nice.
Yeah. And it's always kind of like, whenever I go back, even though my parents are actually from there, from Calabria, and something about it, every time I go back, it just feels like home.
Yeah, you know, like, yes, exactly
kind of like,
right.
I don't know, the soul's home. Or,
yes, you feel very comfortable there, even though you're thousands of miles away. Yeah. It's funny, the first time I went to visit my uncle in Milan. My father's brother lived in Milan. And then coming back, I stopped in Rome. I was alone for the first time. Mm-hmm. And believe it or not, it was the first time in Rome, and I sort of saw it for half a day. I felt so lonely. I remember sitting up in some garden, feeling so lonely, like I was in the middle. I didn't have family. Mm-hmm. I immediately got on the train and went back to Sicily, even though I had just met these people for the first time. You know?
I've done the same.
Yes.
Like I've traveled Italy and been like, I need to go home to Calabria. It's the same thing.
It's
there's something about it. And it's great to have that. It's great to have this kind of, you know, home that's not your home, right? Because you grew up here, but it's kind of like another part of you.
And you feel a connection to the land. It's so strange.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember walking on the beach there and feeling like I belong here. Mm. Like there's something, I've never been here, but it's like I'm home.
Yeah. It's really, it's great. It's
yes, it is.
So do you plan to go back again soon?
I think in October, I was actually named on the advisory board of the John Cabot University in Rome. Uh-huh. And I think the meeting is in October, so I plan to go to Rome in October. I don't know how long I'm going to stay, uh-huh. So...
You'll be like, okay, meeting's over, I've got to get down to Sicily.
Right.
So. Oh, that's fantastic. So what do you do as part of the board?
I've been writing emails and saying, well, I want to know what I have to do. I want to know my response. And I'm a little too eager because I got a little letter back from the chairman. In due time, you will get it back. And, you know, I'm like, well, I want to know. Do I give a speech? Do I meet the students? I'm on the advisory committee for the students. Just happened, like... 2 days ago.
Oh, great.
And you, since you mentioned it, I brought it up.
That's okay.
And I'm very excited about it. I like working with students. I like working with people. You know, I feel like I'm still a student, but I know I'm not. And but, you know, being able to translate what you've experienced and give it to others, try to, you know, this is what I've experienced, and this is how the world is, and let them know different aspects and, yeah. You know, that could possibly be helpful or, So I enjoy doing that, you know. So.
And it's great for young people to have those kind of role models. Maybe you'll meet Anthony over there because he's going, there's an interest in Italy now in Italian-American studies. So Anthony's going over there. Maybe you guys will meet up there.
I'd love to participate.
So what's coming next for you? You've got some projects coming up.
Well, I got two in the can. I got a movie called Zara's Law that a friend of mine, Joe Scarpinito, wrote, and it stars Tony Sirico, and it deals with family. And, you know, when all these Italian projects, they deal with family, you know, and trying to right a wrong, and I did a little part in that. That should be coming out soon. And I just did, John Turturro wrote a movie called, the title is Fading Gigolo. Uh-huh. And he got Woody Allen to be in it. Woody Allen is one of the main characters.
That's
Sharon
a major
Stone.
Feat to get.
Oh, yes. And, you know, I had worked with Woody many years as a prop man. So seeing him on the set was a great, great joy, you know. We did a little scene in that. And that should, John will probably take that to the Venice Film Festival,
I
think, in September. So that should be coming out.
Fantastic.
And right now I'm working on a project called With Anchovies Without Mama. And it's another sort of Italian-American film that deals with our culture and the importance of keeping our cultural identity in the forefront and not losing it. Mm-hmm. And sort of a cross between Marty and Mafioso, a very interesting movie. So we're trying to get that off the ground right now here in New York.
And that was a short film, right?
Yes, it was a short. Tom Giustino is the director, and the short got a lot of sort of coverage and exposure.
It won a lot of awards.
It won some awards as well. But now we're trying to take it to the next step and make a feature
That's
out of
great.
It. The script is complete and everything. Now we're just looking for people to get behind it, and we can get it off the ground.
Fantastic. One question that's coming from all this, you said that storylines and films that deal with Italian Americans, do you think that, I don't know if you've thought about this, but do you think that someday, as we become, let's say, more American, that these stories will not be examined that much? Because right now we're still so close to the immigration and to the first generation.
Yes, but little by little it's going away, and with the age we have now of everything being, you know, we're getting away, everything is here, you know, nothing is like at the dinner table, let's eat, everything's on the run. So yeah, that's sort of like what this movie With Anchovies is sort of dealing with, you know, it's getting further and further away from us, you know, and we're losing that. You know, America is great because it is a melting pot, and it is people from all over the world coming here. But you have to keep some of that, I believe, some of that from of where you come from. And little by little, I think we're losing it. You know, the world is coming just sort of like a one. We're all going to be the same. So.
Right. Yeah.
And I don't know the value, you know. I like to keep it the other way around. I want to have some unique traits of all these different cultures.
Right.
That's, that diversity is exciting, and you get so much out of it.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Very enriching.
Yeah.
Whatever culture.
Right. Well, thanks so much for
bending
being
your
with
ear.
Us.
I didn't talk. All I did was talk. So you didn't know what you were getting into with me.
I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm sure our viewers will too. Thanks so much, Michael.
Oh, my pleasure.
See you again soon. Coming this fall at the John D. Calandra Italian-American Institute, the Philip V. Cannistraro Seminar Series in Italian-American Studies features scholars presenting their current works. October 10th, Paese Mio Bello, an exploration of early Italian-American music with Todd Cambio of the Fraulini Guitar Company. November 4th, The Legacy of Lena Spencer and Her Café Lena with Jocelyn Arem, Café Lena History Project. The Writers Read Series, where Italian-American authors read from their published works. September 26th, Domenica Ruta reads from With or Without You, a memoir. October 21st, Christopher Castellani reads from All This Talk of Love. Documented Italians is a documentary film series that presents films by or about Italian-Americans. October 29th, Antonio Tibaldi's Scomparse, followed by a post-screening discussion with the director, led by Anthony Tamburi, Dean of the Calandra Institute. December 5th, Roman Pasca's Rehearsal for a Sicilian Tragedy, followed by a post-screening discussion with the director, led by Joseph Sciorra of the Calandra Institute. And special presentations. September 12th, exhibition opening, Lo Studio dei Nipoti, four artists. September 19th, a symposium, Italian Identity in the Third Millennium. November 7th, On a Different Shore, Defining Italians, Italian Identity in the Third Millennium, a dialogue with Italian and Italian-American authors at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. November 14th, film screening and book launch, Kevin Carey's and Mark Hillringhouse's All That Lies Between Us, with Maria Mazziotti Gillen's Ancestors Song. Events take place at the Calandra Institute unless specified. 25 West 43rd Street, 17th floor. All events are free. For details and reservations, call 212-642-2094. And visit our website for Calandra Institute and Italics News, and to join our mailing list, qc.cuny.edu/calandra. This fall, Italics continues to celebrate the community with 4-hour-long special episodes dedicated to Italian Heritage and Culture Month. October 10th, 17th, 24th, and 31st. For details, updates, and to watch episodes online, become an Italics fan at facebook.com/italicsiatv. Subscribe to Italics TV on YouTube and follow the Calandra Institute on Twitter at @CalandraITAL. Thank you for watching. We hope you've enjoyed our summer programming. I'm Lucia Grillo. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.